We all grew up in Madras. We all grew up, went through school together in Madras and graduated there. From the time we graduated, then Dave and I went on to college. Dennis went to work at a publisher of paper in Oregon City, and he lives in the lived in the Woodburn area. And Dave went from college, he went and worked for Uncle Sam for a while. And kind of not totally because that was his choice, but because he was asked to.
Told to.
And while Dave was in high school, he was building his Model T, putting it together, and it was his thing, and all the rest of us kind of was, you know, doing other things and not paying too much attention to Dave and his hobby. But then, as he got into the Navy and, you know, thought about the Model T and what to do, he thought, when I get out of the Navy, I'm not going to have a whole lot of commitments in life, so I'm going to get my Model T and I'm going to go for a trip. And so he talked about that. Gene Wright, over here standing in front of sitting in front of my wife, he saw an old article in the Rural Life, and he called me up and asked if that was really us, and if so, would we mind, you know, coming down and sharing that with some of the local people here at the museum. So that's how we come about being here today. So with that, Dave or Dennis, you have any other thoughts? This is a 1917 Model T, so it's 100 years old this year. It was 60 years old when we took this trip, and it's 40 years now since. So
let's crank up.
Crank up. Okay.
You should tell where Kirk lives.
What's that?
Where Kirk. I live on the same place I moved to out of high school in Lama Valley on a farm. My brother and I farmed for a long time now, my wife and I. And lo and behold, Kirk moves in 3 miles from us, 3 miles away, so we have coffee about every day.
Yeah. We get the chance to see each other quite often. And then when we can, we get back over and catch up with Dave, too. We started out at our place, at Dave's place of Madras. This is the ranch just off of the, just down the gravel road a little ways from the highway on Pine Creek. And my father grew up here, and so we stopped and we looked around here a little bit. That old Model A was still there under the tree at the time. And this is some of the old sheet barn stuff there. Concrete cellar house. Old Chevy. Thank you, Dave.
Now that place on Pine Creek is gone now, isn't it?
That place on Pine Creek is totally gone. The people tore down everything that was left, and there's a kind of a really nice ranch headquarters there now.
So how many miles were you averaging a day in the vehicle?
300 was a big day. 100 or a little bit more was kind of a good day.
We camped
most of the way. You'll see that as we go. We stayed in a motel once in a while because we kind of needed a shower about once a week. And it was, you know, hot, kind of muggy weather and whatnot. And we left June 7th or something like that, early June. And that's, you know, so these are the days when we're getting going. Just as a last, kind of a last minute decision, Dave decided, well, let's put some side, I'm going to buy some side curtains. So I have side curtains on the car. Here we are at Fossil, you know, just a few miles from home. And we're already breaking out the side curtains, putting them on because it started thunder showering on us. So
thunderstorm the first day.
A thunderstorm the first day, and we used them quite a bit. It was really a good thing Dave decided to get the side curtains. So then we, from Fossil, we went up. If you've been the back road, rather than going the paved road, you can go up over a hump that's really steep. And we went up, chugging up over that, and Dave was real happy because the Model T was not overheating, it didn't even, you know, steam, so the new radiator that he put in was going to be a good addition because it was pulling really hard getting over that steep grade. And then we dropped back down and we went up into the Blue Mountains, and here we are looking for a place to set up camp. And then from there, after we camped for the night, we went on and we had a thunderstorm with a bunch of hail the next day. From here, we went and stayed overnight. One of my college roommates was living in Pendleton at the time, so we stayed overnight with Jim Hoffman, and he had a pilot's license and a plane that he was able to take us up in. So we got in with Jim, and we went for a ride and got quite a few pictures up in there in the Pendleton area. And at that time, in 77, the circles were kind of a new big deal. So we took quite a few pictures of that, and Jim was there. At the time, he was helping with setting up this new switching yard, I think, in the Pendleton area. This is a railroad switching yard that you see on the left picture there. From there, we headed on east out of Pendleton up toward, I think, went over Tollgate and up toward Enterprise. And from Enterprise, we were going out, even going along with him. Dennis and his family have camped and elk hunted up in the Sled Springs area, so we decided to see if we couldn't get there and camp that this night. So as we were going along, late in the day, we got some good shadow pictures as we were driving along.
Is that your kitchen?
Yes.
That's our kitchen. That's our mobile kitchen.
Afterthought went on the night before.
It was, maybe a few days before, we decided we should have something, so we got together and built that in their shop.
Still on the
car. Same stove and stuff, probably still in it.
Maybe the same food.
From there, as we were heading on down toward Lewiston, Clarkston area, we were going along Joseph Canyon. Okay, here's the picture showing Joseph Canyon.
Did you have Rockies on your
What did you want?
No.
Okay. So that was
low and high.
The question is whether there was auxiliary brakes on the Model T at this time, and there weren't, which means there weren't many brakes. Wasn't much for brakes.
I didn't have emergency brakes either. I had a brick I carried.
That's always good. So here we're out in the Blues Country looking at the ski field.
It's catching up to it. It's a thunderstorm.
Yeah, it started thunderstorming, and Dave got some pictures of that.
About time we get the side curtains on and quit.
So At this point, we're dropping down in toward Clearwater River. And when we got down toward to the river, we were going along. It was getting late, so we thought, oh, we got to find a place. So we found a bridge that crossed it, and then a dirt road that turned off. And we went to the dirt, down the dirt road until we found this gate that said no trespassing. We just camped right here on the river. So the river just off to the left.
And Sasquatch showed up.
As we were leaving, we broke camp the next morning. Dave had to look for a job. We were breaking camp the next morning, and then we took a stop on the bridge and took a few pictures.
Well, we took a bath in the river, remember?
Yeah,
we
it was colder. Down
there, and it was colder than
The son of a gun. We continued on, got into Montana, gone through Idaho, and we were going up the Lobo Pass grade. That was a long pull and no ruck skills, so therefore we just had two gears, high and low, and it was five burner for Dave for miles, going up low over Lobo Pass. And we're headed out toward the Continental Divide. We're near the divide here, where we near Stemple Pass, and we pulled off for the night at this little Stemple Pass there. But anyhow, we pulled off for the night and camped
Lincoln, Montana.
Near Lincoln, Montana, thank you. And where we camped was kind of a campground type place, and this guy was also camping there, named Don Poljo, and his dog's name's was McKeever, and he was an old professor, and he was terrible. So he, as we were setting up camp and stuff, he showed up, we visited. He had a 350 Honda motorcycle that he rode down into whatever, Lincoln, I guess, sometimes he had to go down and have a bike and eat or have a little drink, whatever. He said sometimes if he drank too much, then McKeever would do the driving.
And when we were at the pass, the radiator was leaking into the Pacific and Atlantic at the same time. And we did too.
Don told us that when we were camping, he said to heist your stuff up into the trees because there was a she bear around that was getting into stuff. So crossing the Continental Divide is kind of a big deal. At the top, there's this log cabin. So here's where we were heisting our stuff up in the tree. You can see the whole food box is up there. That, right-hand side.
That's a Model T part. If you sat in the front seat and kicked your heel back, that's what you'd hit. So it was Lolo Pass, the dirt road then?
We were on a gravel road going with Lolo. Not the major route. Or not, no, I shouldn't have said Lolo. Stemple Pass was a gravel road. Lolo Pass is a major highway. The goal was to not be on main roads any more than we kind of needed
back
to.
East, you couldn't do that at all.
No, we were on main roads. We did very little freeway driving. We did a little of that, but very little. We were on secondary paved roads. We were on gravel roads, and sometimes we were on dirt and
cow trail,
two lanes, wheel track.
Really?
So you're going to see some of that as we go through. But yeah, at this point we're on a gravel. I did. I switched it for some dumb reason. I switched from taking slides to prints. Okay. And so and I went to Costco and had them put in a digital form. So I'm going to run them, the prints, through this part of the trip. And they kind of the slides. Interestingly, the slides have made it through the years better than the prints did. The prints became quite brownish colored or sepia tone, so it kind of fits the era. From the divide, we headed for White Sulphur Springs, Montana. And in White Sulphur Springs, we stayed in the motel that actually has the springs associated with it. They had three different heat level of pools, and we went in there and soaked for a while. Then we decided, well, we better go see what goes on in White Sulphur Springs at night. So we went out and found a couple of bars and met some of the locals, and at one point Dave had about, how many people were on your model?
We closed up the bars. The town is two blocks long, and it's prairie without a light in either direction, and the Mint is kind of a famous bar. Anyway, we closed them down, and everyone loaded on my car. I don't know, we had 15 people on it. And this army jeep a guy had, and that was loaded with people. And we drove up and down the streets, and I actually rubbed one of my front hubcaps off on a building.
I think it was the bank.
So it must have been pretty wild. And anyway, so we left our mark in that town. And the next morning, we went back to the Mint, and they gave us Bloody Marys on the house, first thing in the morning. And took pictures of our car, and it got slid under the glass on the bar forever. And so, now we're famous.
The guy at the Mint was, he was from Oregon, so he was really kind of intrigued by us in the car, and it had a, we had a good visit with him, and I went too far there, so anyhow, he and his daughter were out, and that was her. Lower picture here. And they were sitting in the car and kind of enjoying it the morning before we took off. This is some of the other, well, there's the Mint over there. These are some other old characters that were in town. I think we met them maybe the night before. This is the next morning when it's daylight. They got a good picture of them.
Remember the rest of that ED group?
Yeah. We won't go into that here.
Guy riding a T with one arm. And we were, the locals kept saying, we'll go over to this other party. And this guy with the one arm, his wife was following behind him in a pickup, mad at him. He was wanting to go home and he's wanting to go to more parties.
Riding the Model T.
And these are just some locals, sheep rancher, and they were in town and there they are.
White Sulphur Springs, that night, I gotta just say, that night when we were out partying, there was a lot of activity in town. You could just, you know, cars were going here and there, but when you looked out of town, you could probably see about 10 miles of highway straight coming, where it came straight into town or out. There was absolutely no traffic out there. It was totally dark out there, but in town, it was a busy place that night when we were having our, you know, it was probably a Friday night or whatever. These are some of Dennis's relatives' place that we're at with these pictures. The older gentleman, he has one prosthetic leg because he was working on a railroad yard, wasn't he? And he had had his leg caught in the switching, in a track switch, and pinched it off, so he...
He came with jewelry and a pair of watches until he was almost 100 years old. He just died a couple years ago.
But he's a really good old guy. He got around pretty good.
You can kind of see why 24-year-old was hung around this place.
Yeah, this is Dennis's cousin and her friend and the folks. And we stayed there the night, I guess. Yeah, and then from there we headed on further east.
We're on the Crow Indian Reservation.
Saw some rusty iron along the road, and so we stopped and went over and looked at it.
When we got back to the car, this pickup drives up and this guy opens the window and he says, I thought we had the only one of those in eastern Montana. Well, you go on down the road here so many miles and my dad wants to see this.
Yeah, he'll be real so disappointed if you don't stop.
So we did, and that led to much adventure. We were at their place a week.
This is a ranch in central Montana, and the young fellow is the guy in this lower right picture. He and his wife has a child. He and his wife are heading in with some other friends to a movie that evening when they ran across us out on the road. And the father, who is the fellow in this lower picture, he had a whole pile of Model T parts. And he liked Model T's, and he had one that was all restored, and it was in the garage, and it was very nice. And so that's why the son, whose name was Lee, said, my dad will be really disappointed if you guys don't stop. So we stopped, and that was good for everybody, especially for us. We got to meet Phil, as the older fellow, and his wife Mildred, and then we visited with him, and there was a tornado watch going on right at that time when we were traveling through that country. And so we visited for a while, and we were kind of anxious to get on, because Dennis's father had a really close friend whose place was on beyond this that we're headed to, and we're kind of hoping to get there this day. Well, they said, well, you know, this tornado watch is coming, and then we visited, and time went on. They said, well, we have a new Quonset hut that's just been built, never had anything put in it. It's across the road about a quarter mile up there. If you guys want to go camping there for the night, if that way you're out of the weather, you can do that. So we kind of did get moving fast enough to have a better option at that point. So we said, okay, we'll do that. So we went up there and camped for the night, and it stormed on us. We never had any tornado problems, but the next morning we had a heck of a time getting the Model T started. Luckily it was uphill, so we couldn't get it cranked. We did everything we could. We were pushing it. Finally we got it going, and we got down into their farmyard to tell them goodbye and thank you and everything. And Phil, the older guy, was kind of walking around the Model T and looking at it, listening to it. He says, well, I think, you know, that doesn't sound too good. Maybe we ought to look that over and see what it is.
Yeah, we're running kind of rougher and rougher the last couple days. And we take the coils out and we clean them and adjust them and we clean the timer and worse and worse. He said, why don't you hang out here and we'll see what's wrong. Well, it turned out it was the exhaust valves. The only place I knew of that I could get parts when I put this car together was J.C. Whitman's. And I used the original valve springs. Well, they were sacked. And they didn't close the exhaust valves enough, and carbon would build up, and then it would start to warp them. So we ordered new valves out of Rockford, Illinois, and he had a bunch of valves, but I had 64th oversized stems. So all of his were standard. So in about 3 days they came, and while we were waiting for those to come, we also pulled the pan off. He said, well, while you're here, why don't you bring up your rods? Well, they really didn't need it, but I did it anyway. There was a little bit to tape up, and didn't have dippers or any of that. I didn't know about them.
So you're looking up under the bottom of the engine, like four view.
Had a little helper. And the valves came and got them put in, and T ran like a champ again. But while we were there, Dennis and Kirk went out and did their summer follow work, those two tractors. And they were getting behind, and here comes two guys from the farm that knew how to just get on the tractors and do it right. And we really helped them out, and they helped us. Dave and the old man, they played. They did all the work. And then we built this fence around their garden because the milk cow kept getting in there. So Dennis and I built this fence, and they were real happy about that. And their dog's name was Patches.
So, kind of as a follow-up to this story, did you want to tell
In 2008, I drove a Model T to Indiana for the 100th anniversary for the Model T. And I was standing in a field at a fly-in, and this fellow was telling me, he goes, I'm from Montana. And back in 77, he says, I was out in the field, and I heard this noise. I looked up, and there's three young boys in a Model T coming down this road, and running terrible. I said, I know those guys. And he looked at me like, sure you do. And I said, are you the one that did the valve job for him? And he goes, you do know those guys. It's just a long arm of coincidence.
So we really got pretty close to these folks. They had an old log house on the property that nobody lived in for quite a while, and they said, you guys can bunk in there. So we bunked in there, and then I would eat with the younger folks who are the ones on the left, and Dennis and Dave ate with the older folks, so they kind of split up the load of dealing with us. But we helped them out with some of their chores and whatnot, and we spent enough time that we were really pretty close friends when we left. And so then Dennis has a little follow-up as to when he went back 18 years later.
Right there, he took an old Stetson, filled hat, and cut it all out and just left the bill. We call it the Charles D. Gaulle hat. In 77, 18 years later, my wife and I and two of our boys went to a family reunion in Miles City. And on the way back, I said, let's go by the Howard Ranch and see if they're still around. So we drive into this old caravan. I pull up in the driveway, and this guy right here, Rich, right?
Yeah, Rich. No, that's Lee. Lee and Linda.
Lee is now a middle-aged guy. He comes walking over, and he looks, and I roll down the window, and he's looking at me like this. I says, you don't know who I am, do you? And he goes, no. He says, are you some damn hunter or something? And I said, well, maybe you remember if I told you the last time I was here, we rolled in a 17T. And he goes,
oh my goodness, and he reached in and he almost yanked me out the window. He starts shaking me and goes, which one are you? And then both of his parents were in their 80s, mid-80s, and they were still alive, and they had us in for a big feed, and we spent a few hours there before we moved on.
So it was, that was fun getting to know those folks. One of the, I guess that's one of the things that I take away from that I had of this trip, and then through the years, you watch the news, and you think, man, there's a lot of bad people. America's a bad place. There's all this negative stuff you see in the news. But when you get a chance to do something like this, where you go and you actually meet the people that live out across our country, there's so many wonderful people that are out there. And they're, you know, this is really a great country, and it's nice to have got the chance to get to go visit and know some of these folks. So anyhow, as we moved on, we were going then from these folk place out tea running better, and we're headed on to Newell Philbrick's place, which was one of Dennis's dad's best friends when he grew up. And so we're going to be heading that direction. And we're going through, at this point, we're going through that part of the country, coal strip. So they were taking all the topsoil off, taking about a 12 to 20 foot band of coal, mining it out of the ground, and then they take the topsoil and they put it back on. And they changed the countryside from interesting, you know, little hills with trees and stuff on it, kind of, and then ends up being just kind of rolling grasslands, good pasture. I mean, as far as productivity, is probably better, but it kind of hurt me to see that new scenery go away as the coal was being taken out. But anyhow, we don't have to make too much of an environmental statement here. Now, here we are. See, that's some of the countryside where you have the hill goes up and then those trees and the little outcropping of rocks. Yeah, on the high spots. So now we're at Philbrick's here on with the windmill. You can see it down below. They had 30,000 or 50,000 acres or something like that in their ranch. Dennis probably has those numbers. You might have that in mind. And so once we got there, we went out. They had to go check the well to make sure that the cattle were having water. So we got to go with them out to one of their windmills and their water places. And we're checking that here.
They didn't go by acres, they went by sections.
Yeah.
They asked him what the smallest pasture. So, well, bull pasture, three sections. It's the smallest.
So this is Newell on the right here, and his wife is the second one in, and then they have three daughters, and that was their place that we're at. While we were there, we stayed there a couple nights, I think, and one night it was a weekend and they had a dance going on in town. And he said, oh, you can take our Ford pickup, and, you know, you guys can drive that in. It was only about 40 miles to drive or something like that, but oh, take the pickup, go on in, go to the dance. And so anyhow, they are really great folks, and they just quite
three daughters and an entire granddaughter. Multiple choice.
So they were really good. Just, I remember that at their place we slept on the trampoline out back. It was warm weather, so that was a good place to sleep. He was pretty progressive because he did a lot of kind of re-leveling of his hay ground and stuff, and then he had these gated pipes. And that was when these were kind of a new thing, and that's how he did his irrigation. Yeah, I think that if I remember right, he said you fill your tank before you leave. So we're really appreciative of that. And he said, I got a good friend who runs KYUS TV in eastern Montana, and we were headed near Baker, Montana. We were headed that direction. He said, I'm gonna call him up and you guys stop there. You stop and visit, stop in and see him. So we stopped and he came out and car and said, okay, he said, I want to get my camera stuff. He said, I'm going to interview you. So he came out there with, you know, started interviewing us. And he asked questions and we answered them and we talked back and forth. And it probably went on for about 10 minutes or something like that. And when he was concluded, he said, well, or we asked him, well, how much of that will probably air this evening? Because he
put it on the news. I said, oh, all of it. I said, I don't do any cutting. our kind of informal, I mean, all the informal stuff, it all went on whatever their evening news was. And this place, this TV station was so rural and small. I think it was the smallest one in the U.S., he said. And there'd be people, it might be some of the local citizens, if somebody was late getting back because they were at a meeting somewhere in another town or whatnot, many times they'd call him up and say, would you mind announcing that I'm going to be late tonight because I'm not going to get back in time and my wife's going to be wondering what's going on. So he would actually do something like that. And if I remember right, another thing is he did very little negative news. Almost everything he did, he just the positive stuff. Not the way it is anymore,
is it? This is downtown Miles City. That's my dad's
hometown. When we left Miles City in this Cayuse station, kept going east, and we were right near the border, the Montana-North Dakota border, as evening fell, and we needed a place to camp, but it was pretty wide open, so we said, well, we'll just drive out through a field here. We went out near where some oil wells oil pumps were running, and we set up camp for the night. Nobody around. We didn't test anything. So we were in the middle of the night. It seems like it was like 2 or 3 o'clock. We hear this plop, 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 and that is enough to woke us up. I think it's starting to rain. Conferred.
The old bright flashes were good, right?
Oh, we got flashes too. Let's get up and break camp and get, you know, see if we can get in the car. So be real fast.
The tent leaked.
Well, plus it's going to be all wet and everything would be a problem to put away. So we got up real fast. We, you know, got our sleeping bags and got the tent rolled up, put it on the car, got the side curtains out of the car and put them on. And it was getting wetter and wetter as we was doing this. It was raining. The rain was coming. And then we got it all together and got the car, but now it's like 3:30 in the morning. And that's kind of a bummer because we aren't really very set for driving at night. So we started it up and we drove out near the highway, which is maybe a mile or less, and shut everything down, and then we tried to sleep the rest of the night in the car. That wasn't not a very comfortable rest of the night.
The other evening before it started raining, we were parked real close to big oil pump. It ran on some kind of a fuel. And when it was lift and underloaded, then when it was going down, it went.
Seen that
burnt
valves too.
So we had a terrible time going to sleep to begin with.
I didn't remember that part of it. So anyhow, we had to do our best to try and sleep till it became light enough for us to get on the road. And then we headed on east from there. So that was a memorable night. And we get into Hettinger, North Dakota. And wasn't it Hettinger where the guy... What was that?
There's a thunderstorm in
town. Yeah, one of the thunderstorms. But there, a guy came out there who... Actually, if I remember right, the guy at the service station said, I'm going to call my buddy down at the newspaper because he'll want to come talk to me. So he came and he was up to that point, he was the most professional type of an interviewer that we visited with. And he asked a bunch of questions and got a whole bunch of information. And he said, well, I'm gonna run my article. And so then we came to find out as time progressed, he got his whole article together and he put it on the Associated Press, I think. Which would send that article out, basically broadcast it to whoever wanted to, found an interest, and then they could pick it up and run it in their paper or whatever. So from his story that he wrote, then all of the different places across the United States, then there were in the 4th of July newspapers, a whole lot of newspapers ran an article about these guys traveling across the United States.
Dave? And he got on Paul Harvey 3 times. And he'd say, 3 young farmers crossing America in a Model T Ford. And I'd the rest of the story would be the next day.
So, we needed to get to South Dakota, if I remember right, because you could get fireworks there. So we were headed that direction.
The water out of that picture pump was terrible. We sold the water, and the guy was getting it, he said, "Oh, this is the best water we have anywhere."
Some road travel was had some traffic. Got hung up in a traffic stop here. And one evening came and looking for a place to stay, we talked to some people and said, "Well, there's a church right down the road here. Why don't you just stay in the, it's all right if you stay in the churchyard." So we pitched our tent in that churchyard that night. And the church wasn't locked or anything, so we wandered in and looked around. It had a big old neat organ in it. Somebody has a picture of that here. But
is that some TP in your hand there, Kirk, and not a tree in sight?
So anyhow, we camped there that night, and then Dave was noticing the wheels were getting a little loose. See, the next morning then, we had to do a little shimming up the spokes on the wheels before we got going. Quite a few mornings we didn't get going too quick in the morning, it seemed like. Can you imagine?
We'd give rides. There was people around, we'd give rides sometimes clear till afternoon. And then we'd leave, and so we didn't get a lot of miles in on those days.
And a lot of times when we'd stop, especially some of the older folks that had grown up with Model T's as some of their transportation in their lifetime, they would kind of wander over and they'd kind of get to looking at it, and then you'd visit with them and say, kind of start getting a little conversation going. And before long, they were telling the story about when they had the Model T, and boy, we heard some pretty good stories about people in there. Yeah, those folks that grew up with the Model T being their first transportation with wheels, yeah, they're pretty well gone now.
Well, that car was 60 years old then. Now it's 100.
Yeah.
This picture on the bottom, we got on a right-of-way in Minnesota, and everything's on a grid there. We followed this right-of-way, he said, "Let's just stay on this one." Well, for a ways it'd be paved, you'd come to a little town, and then it'd be paved out of that town, then it turned to gravel, then it turned to dirt, like this. But we persevered, we stayed on it, the right-of-way fences were there. Pretty soon this turned into a track for a cow. And we were bouncing along over the sod, and we came to a salt lick, and we went around it, continued on, the right-of-ways are still there. No gates we had to go through, and pretty soon it turns back into two tracks, and pretty soon it turned into gravel, and pretty soon it's paved again, and
made it through.
And we made her all the way through. As near as we could tell, this was about the section line we're crossing there, and it's between South Dakota and Minnesota. We were in the city of, Silver Lake. Yeah. In a little town, we were driving around in town, and all of a sudden it sounded like the crankshaft worked. But it kept moving.
A real hard knock.
Yeah, it was a real hard knock. Got out, looked around, and finally realized that thing had broken. So we went to these guys here on the left, one of them had a little shop. And Kirk loaded it up, and then we found their Model T stories. The one in the center went over the Sierra Nevadas with his dad in a Model T, and it was raining, it was horrible, they were in a hurry, it was only running on two cylinders, but they just kept going, because they wanted to get to where they were going. There was more to it than that, I don't remember the whole story, but it sounded miserable.
Is that a real Model T horn shim?
Yes.
Yeah. And you don't need to run a water pump.
This part right here.
I had a water pump on there, and I really didn't need it. Who's better without it? But it was on there, and it was, there it is.
So the reason that there was such a noise coming from this being broken, this piece bolted onto the body, and this part bolted onto the frame. So as you went over things that were a little rough, they would separate and then slam back together, so pounding pretty hard at times, and that's why we were concerned.
And it has been welded there, but the weld is just just on one side, but it's held clear till today, so Kirk welded it, and so he did a good job.
Yep, again, people letting us use their equipment. I mean, what are we paying, 50 cents for the rod or something like that? You let us fix it up, keep going. So then as we get into, we're in Iowa, here in this lower picture. I guess we're, Dennis, the lower picture on the left and the top of, we're in Minnesota, we're in St. Paul, and this fellow up here on the left, well, I'll tell you more about him. Dennis is, this is your relatives there, Dennis. Talk about them first, because we stopped to visit them and we called the bird from there. And this is your, was she a relative? So anyhow, Dennis contacted them as we were going into St. Paul, and then while we were visiting them, we contacted Mr. Zarns, who's standing there. And he's a guy that a few years earlier, when Dave and John were based in Japan and in the Navy, Dennis and I took a trip, and we went and visited them, and then we went on to Hong Kong, and while we were in Hong Kong, we met this fellow. He was a grain trader from the St. Paul area. He was based in Hong Kong. Dennis and I, when we got there, it was hot dang muggy, and we got off the plane, and we went out, and we got a taxi ride, and this guy charged us $10 Hong Kong, I think. He took us to the Royal Inn or something like that, motel. And that one, when you turn the lights on, you can see the cockroaches headed for the dark corners. It wasn't too royal, actually. And so we weren't real thrilled there. But, oh yeah, we found out later the taxi ride should have been $2 rather than 10 Hong Kong. But that was still like a 5-to-1 ratio. The American dollar, so still none of it was really expensive. It's just that we should have done better. So then we decided, well, we don't like the Hong Kong part of it too well. No, we were in the Kowloon, and we wanted to. So then we took the ferry and we went over to the Hong Kong, which is all one kind of metropolis with a river or a sound or harbor there between. So we went over there. And we got into the nice section of town, and for like $60 a night, we had a hotel. It had air conditioning, and it was like really nice. Because over there, there were days that it was 95 degrees and 95% humidity, and that was, oh, it's muggy. Anyhow, so we finally got ourselves kind of reoriented to a better place, but then we still didn't have much direction. So Dennis and I wandered out, down outside, out on the street, and we went to a street corner, and there was a bench there. And we sat on that bench, just kind of being there, just observing Hong Kong from that particular point at that particular time. And this guy, he walked across the street, and he kind of glanced at us, and then he turned and he walked over to us and asked us what was going on. He said, "You guys don't look like you have too much going on around here."
Like,
he said,
"Looks like you guys are lost."
Kind of lost, he said.
Right.
So he came over there and visited with us, and we got to know each other a little bit. Well, my wife wasn't expecting anybody else to come home. She says, "But why don't you come with me and I'll let her know and maybe you can have supper with us." So we went over and we spent the evening with them and had supper and became really pretty close friends. And then off and on during the time we were in Hong Kong, we would meet up with them and we'd go to some place to eat. And so by the time we left Hong Kong, they were kind of like our parents there, and it was really fun to have got to know them, and they made Hong Kong a lot more interesting and worthwhile for us. So when we were taking this trip, we wanted to see those folks again. So Dennis and I contacted her while we were visiting these ladies, and he drove over and met us, and then we followed him to his place, so that way we had a way to get there. So anyhow, then we went. We spent the night with them.
Well, we had to take that freeway, and it was a 45 mile an hour limit.
Lower limit.
Yeah, that was as low as you could go.
Yeah.
So I pulled both ears down, and by golly, we kept up with traffic.
And you were doing 50 or something like that, because I was riding with Herb, and I could, remember giving you, you know, numbers just about how fast they were.
Oh, yeah.
No speedometer.
We really understood why they're called flippers.
We were flippering right along.
That's the Mississippi River. It's not very big up that far north.
And now we're in Iowa. Got into Iowa. We're
Wisconsin.
Going, oh, Wisconsin. Thank you, Dennis. See? So when we're going along, there's this guy with horses out doing some cultivating. And so we thought, oh, that's kind of cool. So we stopped and took some pictures. And he didn't seem to mind. He stopped. And so then we got to visiting. And he was a Mennonite. And they had just started a Mennonite colony here in Wisconsin. He was out cultivating his field at the time. So after visiting, he said, well, come on over to my place. So we went over, and he was a wheelwright. He made and rebuilt wheels for the Mennonites, the local Mennonites, wagons and stuff, and their buggies. And so anyhow, as we were visiting with him and got to know him, the kids came out, and we were interacting and stuff. He said, well, come in and have some pie, if I remember right. So we were invited into their house. It was a very plain house, and the pie was like a meat pie or sort of a casserole or a stew-like dish. It was good. It was, you know, kind of unique from what we were used to. And so then he said, I think Dave asked him, well, do you want to take a ride in the Model T? He said, yeah, I'd like that. They couldn't drive a wheeled vehicle, but they could ride it. So we went over to where they were building their church for their new colony or community. And the first thing they build when they start making a church is the stables for their horses. And that's what this building is along this side here. That's where the horses can be protected out of the sun or out of the snow or whatever. And that's the most important. And then from there they were building the church. And they had people that came in from Pennsylvania colony, and they came in by bus, and they were there to help build the church. So here's their pet duck or something over there. Some of the kids around look at the engine of the Model T with Dave.
I'm in heaven to explain Model T mysteries to these guys. Lots of questions. I loved it.
There's their buggy. That was their transportation back and forth. You saw quite a few of those style buggy up there. Okay, and this is out on the road. That's their stables that we'd seen from the other side a little while ago. There's the roof facility. See that? Yes, it's made for a lot of horses.
A Wisconsin barn. Probably taking a lot of lightning hits this day.
And then we went off the road to have lunch or something, or we saw this lake and decided to explore a little. So we went down and parked and got out, and there's an old couple there, and they were out fishing. And
they're fishing that way.
And so we got to visit with them, and they were quite characters.
Send us a brick of Wisconsin cheese for Christmas right
there. A couple here, their son was in the Navy with me. His name is Martin Burke Island. He was quite a character. I told him, when I take this trip, I'll stop in at your parents' house in Wisconsin and say hi. And we found them, and there they are.
So, but Dennis is remembering that we didn't even find them at their house. We had to go look them up out of camp.
They were out camping, and we got directions where they were camping and in another part of the state. And here they are showing us some good routes to take from there on. And that's the dad and two of the boys and the daughter down lower there. And Martin kind of looked like the kid facing us. He was quite a character. And that's at the Mackinac Bridge. Yeah, and on one side it was cold and windy. And so we took the bridge across, and it took a while to get across, and on the other side it was hot and muggy. Just boom, one environment to the next. That's on the other side, and it's warm, and this turtle was crossing the road, and we saved his life.
Hey, what's that picture?
The troll came out of Lake Michigan.
Wrong bridge. I think I was a bridge too far.
down to a smaller bridge.
So then, Dave, tell the story about why we were here.
Well, why we were there was my grandparents that lived in Chicago had a cottage in this area along Lake Michigan, and when we were little kids, we'd take the train back and stayed part of the summer there, and it was a wonderful place for kids. This bridge crosses some water pole, which they called it a channel, and it was, I don't know, it was pretty wide and about 3-4 inches deep and warm, and you could walk in it, and there'd be holes under logs, and there'd be fish and things going. Just a paradise for little boys. And it's near Mears, Michigan, before it was near. And this cottage was all built out of driftwood stuff. And another family that lived, I don't know, I'd say in this little area there was a dozen little cottages that people lived in private. And this family, their boys built this, and the family remembered me that they were on top there. And they said, well, why don't you guys stay overnight in the driftwood house?
So we did. Beach fort. There was a thunderstorm that night while we were there. Is that you and Dennis, Dave, on that canoe on the lake?
Kind of looks like it.
Yeah, I think so.
Took dune scooter rides. It's kind of a tourist area. Hey, sand in there, and you do scooter rides. Pretty cool. So we were buzzing along, headed towards Chicago. My grandparents were still alive and living there. And
so were Christians.
Yeah, and this Model T catches up and passes us. It's this guy. And really ran good. He was just running on 6-volt battery. He must have had his coils really cranked up. But anyway, he slows down and we stop, and he says, come to my house. So we followed him to his house and ate, and he showed us his little fleet of cards.
His name was Jerk Retzema, or Ritzema.
Yeah, like. Jerk.
Jerk.
Yeah.
That's what he went by anyhow. He wasn't a jerk.
There's the cops. So, I'm in handcuffs.
So we're in Indiana going along. So we coming down around the lake. And you have to go through Indiana way before you get into the Chicago area. And we were in Indiana, then the cops pulled us over.
And it's hot, and it's humid.
So he decided he needed to handcuff Dave so he'd get the cuffs out there.
I'm saying, but it wasn't me.
Yeah, Dave did some fast talking and got him to start us so we could go on down the road.
But they stopped us because they were just fascinated and they wanted to find out what the... So we stopped and we visited and we gave them... They wanted our addresses so they could write and know how we were doing, or we could let them know how we were doing. And they wanted to crank it and say they'd started a Model T. Now this is not a generator car, it's just hand crank only.
So unless Dave had some experience that Dennis and I didn't know about with the cops, this is the only time that we were stopped.
Dave sent a picture of this to his dad at Madras and said, we got a speeding ticket. And his dad reported it to the Madras Pioneer and they put it in the paper. Yeah, well, the one guy, the one reporter in South Dakota put us on the AP wire. The story came out all over the U.S. and Hawaii as a human interest story for the 4th of July. And people that knew my parents from all over the country wrote and said, well, is this your son? From Madras, Oregon, Dave Campbell. And, no, no, no.
And a lot of the people that we had met or friends of our families, they clipped those articles out and they sent them. And we have 5 copies of a booklet that we put together about our trip. It's back there, kind of a daily log. And then in the back part are some photos of a lot of those clippings that you can see. So if you want, they're back there for you to look at it as we go through the day. And if you'd like to look at them, you're welcome to. But anyhow, there's quite a few clippings from different places in the country that came from 4th of July papers that we ended up with, which is nice.
We made it into where my grandparents lived in the depths of Chicago, but we had to drive through kind of like the Lower East Side.
The ghetto area.
The ghetto area, and we were a parade. They just loved us. And if you wave to people before when they look at you, well, as soon as you wave to them, you've made them special. And they'd wave back, and they'd be standing around
doorways into buildings you maybe never want to go into, and even those guys get smiles and wave back. And cars would come up next to us and want to race, you know. Well, yeah. We finally made it into my grandparents, and that's Meemaw and Peapod. And
when we got there, it was evening time, not dark yet. And so we went and rung the doorbell and didn't get an answer. So we thought, well, they must be out somewhere doing it, you know, on an errand. So we went to the park across the street and we sat and waited for about an hour. And after a while, no activity. So we said, well, we better be a little more persistent. So we went back over and knocked again, and we got them up. They'd already gone to bed out of their room.
We should have used our cell phones.
Dave and I took a side trip into J.C. Whitney, got some parts while we were there on the bus. We enjoyed visiting with Dennis, and I really got a chance to visit with Dave's granddad one day when it was a real hot month. Day. We were in the basement, it was cool down there. And he was a negotiator at the car manufacturer, one of the car manufacturers. And so he would go and he would talk with the employees and hear what their concerns were, and then he would go and visit, talk with management, and he'd be the intermediary between them when they got together to negotiate. So he really had some interesting insights that I appreciated him sharing with us. He says, one thing is, he says, you've got to think of how to communicate with people. And he said, when I go and I'm communicating with the employees, I say just as many cuss words, and I talk the language that they talk, and that's what they respect. He said, if I go in and talk and don't use the cuss words and all that kind of stuff, they think I'm highbrow and I'm above them, and they won't talk to me. But he says, when I go to management, then I got to talk more proper and not use all the cuss words and stuff. So, you know, and I never had really thought of language in those terms before, and it was interesting to get to share that with Dave's grandfather and how his employment, he learned that.
He's my granddad on my mom's side. His name was Fred Storner, which is my middle name. And it's kind of a rare name. It was the only one in the whole Chicago phone book. He was friends with all the neighborhood kids. He was grandpa to all of them. They had a huge urban garden before it was the thing.
So when we left Chicago, Dennis can tell the story, because he had some relatives down south of Chicago in Illinois. We were headed that way.
Oh, yeah.
Indiana?
Yeah. No, it was in Illinois. We left Chicago. And there's another story, Dave maybe forgot this. When we were there, his granddad gives him this little 25 automatic.
Yeah.
So we had it for the rest of the trip, but we just barely got out of Chicago. We stopped and pulled over and put some cans along the ditch. We're shooting this right along the highway.
I didn't remember that either.
I did.
Made a little popping sound.
But we were on the way to visit my relatives, and my mother gave us, my dad, my parents gave us a big list of friends and relatives across the U.S. and all the contacts. So we were headed to Roberts, Illinois to go spend the night with these cousins of my dad's. We get into this Roberts, Illinois. It was about, 50 miles from Chicago or something?
About that, yeah.
And we're driving all over town looking for East Plum Street. And everyone, it was a little, it was about the size of Culver. Once in a while we see somebody, we pull over and say, where's East Plum Street? I go, I'm not sure. And finally this guy, I can't even remember his name, we ran into him, and he had a Suburban gas dealership, and he delivered gas everywhere. So we asked him where East Plum Street was, and no East Plum Street in this town. So I dig in my backpack and I pull out and look at the all the information, and it was Robinson, Illinois, not Roberts. We were 200 miles away. So they said, well, you're not going to make it there tonight. You just will come and spend the night with us.
So another complete stranger that we just happened to meet takes us home to their home, and the bags out in the basement. We stayed with them for the night.
That was our second tornado warning night, too, remember?
I do remember that. Good reason to be in a basement, I guess. So after the next morning we got up and we had a nice, really nice breakfast, and they got us on the road. And here's some of the farm ground we're going through.
When I was in FFA, I won the decal, some kind of award. I don't remember what it was. It was sponsored by decal, so I want to get a picture of that sign. I'm taking a picture of the sign, and Dave takes a picture of me taking a picture of the sign.
Is this the night that we went into, where it was getting late, we went into this town and we're trying to figure out where to camp? And
on the way here, we stopped at this, and the old boar laid down in the fairing gate.
If this is the camp spot, we asked the locals, well, where do you camp? They said, well, where might we camp? They said, oh, you just go out of town and you'll come to this bridge, just before the bridge, take off and drive down in, you can drive back to the trees and stuff down there. They said that shouldn't be a problem there. So we drove down there, got all set up, and I guess it was a weekend evening again, because it became a little active down in there. As night came, there were the lovers that came and went, and every time some lights would come in, there, you know, that we, you know, we wonder what's going on, and if they're going to be harassing us, and kicking us out or anything. So then we'd have to kind of get up and look and see. Oh no, it's all right. They weren't there to harass us. And then that happened a few times, and then some more lights came in, and then we hear all these guys out, and they're talking, and we hear, this dog's barking. We wonder, well, what in the heck's going on? And we're kind of really a little concerned where we fit in.
I don't remember why we were concerned, because we asked somebody in town where we could camp.
What those dogs sound like?
Yes. Why don't you tell us?
And remember, they said, just follow us out.
Well, they were coon hunters.
We went out, and on our way in, there was big, no trespassing, keep out signs.
That's right.
We're following them, and we're getting down in there, and they took us back in there a quarter mile. And he said, are you sure we can stay here, you know? So we were uneasy whenever we could drive up anyway, because we didn't know we were going to get shot.
So then, with all this commotion, he said, well, we better see if we can't figure out what the heck's going on. So we wandered over, started visiting these guys, and they were coon hunters. And so they were out with their hounds, and they were getting all ready to go out and see if they could tree a coon somewhere. So they said, oh, no, we aren't going to bother you guys. I mean, we aren't here to bother you guys. You guys can go camp, stay the night. And so they went out and did their thing, and we ended up getting a half a night's sleep.
You remember the camp? We were on a lake. And on the far side of it, there were some houses.
It's on.
On the far side of it, there were house lights on. But on our side, here's this rowboat.
Yeah.
Remember, we just got in it and went rolling all around the lake, and it was like midnight on the water. And it was really magical. No wind, it was warm, after dark, and so it wasn't too warm. And you remember that?
I remember.
Yeah.
I remember we had a jar. We were intrigued by the fireflies. We put a whole bunch of them in a jar. We took them back to the tent, and Kirk was trying to sleep, and went in there and shook them, and you know, they all got bright. I said, why don't you guys just go to bed?
But a lot of our campsites were like that. You could just pull down off the highway and just kind of worm your way back through the trees and just out of sight. Yeah. And the team would go back in there real easy, and then it blended in. So that was a good way to camp.
Yeah, people didn't seem to bother us.
And that was a tornado that we barely missed.
And we kept going. Now you see we're getting into Pennsylvania and oil fields. Davis cycled out of that one.
Pulled down into this refinery, and we thought it was abandoned, but it wasn't.
We're in Pennsylvania, and what do you think? Where do you think Pennzoil started? I guess it's the three guys here that they came out and were looking the Model T over, and we got to visit with them.
We had spent a week and it was time for a motel. So we were getting showered, spent the night, and it was starting to run rough again. We were fiddling with the tire and points and coils, and the only we know, we were burning the valves for the second time.
It took one quart every day. You didn't even have to check. You just poured it in. Then what was left of the cap, you just dribble that over the kingpins. And there you go.
Good to go. So as we get into Pennsylvania, and us being ones who kind of looked at old rusty stuff, we stopped, or we saw some old stuff out in the trees and the brush and whatnot. And went out there, we thought, man, this is old oil pump stuff, and it's really old and
abandoned.
Abandoned looking. You can see there were electrical wires. They were hanging down through the branches, and some places you had to kind of duck to get under them.
And they went clear down into the forest duff, and they were buried in the forest duff.
Yeah, there's these pipes and these old grasshopper type pumpers. And so I guess, just being curious young people, went over to this what looked like an electrical outlet box and flipped the switch and the pump started pumping. now see how long the shaft is right there, what the position of that is. Now look how it's down. So it actually did start up, for we could not believe it.
Nobody else did in the next town we were telling about it, and they said, "How's it been abandoned for years?" And again, it just started up, and that induction motor went right off and ran. What did it sound like?
So that was kind of an interesting little find.
How old were you guys when we did this?
24 years old.
The dentist drove from where that oil pump was. Dennis was driving, and it was a log, steep downhill. And you learned
that you don't ride the brake. So by the time we got down into this little town called Tiu, Pennsylvania, no brakes left. So he learned how to pull a band out. We re-riveted a new lining on it using the front hub. It was a very nice, you could lay the band over that front hub, and so when you tap the rivet in, it would splay apart very nicely. It was the way I always do them. And all these kids came along and were real interested in this whole episode.
And during that process, it was threatening a thunderstorm, and they got permission from the local car wash to push it in under the canopy over the car wash. So that's how the job got finished up, was securing a dang downpour of a thunderstorm under it in a car wash. And then it was getting late in the day. We're trying to figure out, well, what are we going to do? Is there any motel around? Where are we going to stay for the night? Well, we better go have a drink and think about this. So we went into the local bar, and I think we played a little pool and visited. And the guy that was the owner, listen, he said, "Well, he said, if you guys want, you can stay in. I got kind of a garage out, on the side of the building. You can stay in there." So it was an open-sided gravel on the floor, but it was a roof. So we ended up camping in there, rolling our sleeping bags in there for the night. And that was welcome. It was, thunderstorming wet weather. Then the next morning, when we got up, it seemed like Dave or Dennis, one of them, pretty slow getting up. But I was ready to go, so I went into the little local dining. There was like a general store, and they had a couple of tables and a bar and stuff for people to sit and order at the buffet. So I went in there and wrote the journal to kind of get things cut up. And when Dave and Dennis came in, then we ordered breakfast. We wanted dry cereal, so we said cornflakes or whatever. And we watched them, they just go over to the shelf, and they just get a box of cornflakes and bring it over and set it on the table. Well, there's your cornflakes.
Quarter milk.
Yeah, and then they went into the cooler and they got a half gallon jug of milk and brought it over and set it on the table.
Over the years, I've run into people from other states and
several times I ran into people from Pennsylvania and said, oh, we spent a night in Kitty, Pennsylvania. He said, I never heard of that. Several people they never heard of.
We were off the beaten path. We got into the bird watching after we left Kitty, I think. And is that right? Yeah. Dave wanted to do some bird watching, so we stopped where there was a bunch of brush and flowers and whatnot. Dave, okay, Dennis can pick it up from here.
Dave was bird watching with binoculars, and I was taking pictures of flowers, and exploring the flowers. And Kirk was writing in his journal. Those two big studs come by in a pickup. Their sleeves rolled up and they just looked at us and they just shook their head. I said, you guys gotta be a bunch of fairies.
Well, I gotta go about
I came across this big old stump with these huge mushrooms. They had fed a family. Go to small family.
So then as we finally got done with that stop and moved on, I think there's some road construction going on or something, and it was about time we wanted to have some lunch, so we pulled off the side of the road and we got looking, and it looked like some kind of a pump out in the brush. It was kind of a meadowy-like area, and you can see trees and whatnot, but all these ferns, and then you see these pipes, and there was cable, and so we started looking around there, and these tripod things, and we'd see the pump, and we'd follow from that pump, we'd follow a cable, and it'd go through these tripods, it'd go out through the trees and the grass and stuff. And finally, it came to this building, and there were several of them that came to this one building. And in that building, there was a motor, like an old one-lunger engine or something like that, okay, this building. And it would run, the way it was set up, it would run, and all of the pumps that were outlying were hooked to these cables, and it would cause those cables to pull, and then that would cause the pump to come up. I don't know exactly how it all worked, but that one engine ran several different little pumps right there in that meadow area.
There must have been a dozen pumps.
Yeah, quite a few.
They were all spread out as much as a quarter mile away, and all connected to this one power source, so it ran the whole works.
Yeah.
And there was a belt pulley that ran out to that other little building, and there was a turntable that went round and round with a pin, and all those cables were connected to that. And it was, I've never seen anything like it. I wish I had that motor at home now.
So we continued on, we got into New York. In New York, we went through Sharon, New York, and it was getting late. And if I remember right, we ended up driving on a freeway, a pretty major road, and Dave got his flashlight out. This might have been the first time that it was a Navy one that had a red lens on it. And he'd take that to the back tail light for our tail light. Because otherwise, you just had a gas one, I think, back here, didn't you? And then, of course, the headlights weren't too great, but we kept going on down the road. So I think we finally got a motel or someplace that night. And then, he wasn't running very good, and we got into New York. Get into New York, and we're having problems with the running again. This is the second time the valves have gone out.
But I had spare valves, and so it was quick work to get the spare ones in. And, we had to order more?
We had to order more, because you guys went to Spanky. Spanky is this guy, Jack and Ann, Spanky was the name. We had stopped at a Union gas station. And we kind of decided that maybe we were having a valve problem again. So Dave, we went in and talked to the guy at the gas station if we might use a bay and work on the Model T, and he didn't like that idea. So as we were plotting, trying to figure out how we're gonna, go from this point, people started, and it was kind of common that people start kind of drifting in, seeing the car. They wouldn't necessarily at first interject themselves into what we were doing. They just kind of observed and whatnot. So the crowd gathered while we were discussing what we were going to do next. And one of the guys was this Jack, who had the body shop across the street.
And after a while, he kind of stepped up and said, well, he said, maybe I can help you guys. He said, I got a body shop over here, and I know some people around that have old cars and parts and stuff. So that, with that, Dennis and Dave went across the street, and they went into his auto body shop, into his office, and they started calling to see if they were, he could locate somebody who had some valves for the teeth. Because we got him in Montana thinking that we were fixed. Well, we burned him out again. So he was trying to help locate. And I thought, well, I better stay with the car. So I stayed over there and I wrote in the journal for, I think, about 2 hours. Because, you know, I didn't know the neighborhood. And I wanted to wire take stuff. So finally, I gave up staying with the car and wandered across the street. Here they are sitting in his office with their feet up on the desk. And they're just having a good old BS session. No, of course, no parts got ordered because they couldn't find anybody that had the reason that was a problem is because when Dave rebuilt the engine, he put oversized stem valves, 1/64th over, in the car, in the Model T, so just regular old Model T valves couldn't just be swapped into it. So the long and short of it is, he couldn't find anybody who had them, so we ended up again having to order J.C. Whitney. And so then we were in the dilemma of, well, here we are, and we were thinking, well, maybe we can find a motel that's not going to be too expensive. And so as we talked about that, Jack said, well, he said, why don't you come over and have a sandwich at our place? And so we got the tea fired up, followed them over to their place, and we had a sandwich, and we were visiting, one thing led to another. They said, well, you guys just roll out on our living room. So we stayed on their rug floor and sofa in the living room, and the long and short of it, since we had to order parts, we were kind of stuck there for several days, but we kind of became part of the neighborhood, and the neighbors across the street were the people in the lower left corner. They had a yard sale during the time we were there, and we went to that, got to know them a little, and you'll see several pictures of us. Oh, that girl, the girl that was on the lower picture that was on the porch, looking at the camera, she was the daughter of Ann, and her name's Laura, but we called her Girl. She didn't like that very good at first, but in the end, she was Girl. Even to her, she was Girl when she was talking to us. Yeah, Jack and Ann were not married. They lived together, and the girls were, Ann had three girls. And the older ones were pretty well gone from the house a lot of the time, I think one was married. Anyhow, they were really wonderful folks. They were wonderful to us. And we got, here's the some of the neighbors here. Anyhow, there's several pictures here. The pool in the neighbor's backyard.
We bought bow ties at the yard sale. I bought that shirt.
Well, we were going to have an interview. Remember, there was the local TV station was coming over to interview us, and you wanted to look your best.
We kind of made peace in the neighborhood.
Yeah, tell them about it.
Jack and Ann were both divorced, and they lived together on one side of the street. And the neighbors across the road, the dad, everything was nice and proper, nice. Everything was organized in the house, spotless. He was a executive for IBM. And they had whatever their religion was, they were strong in their faith, and the lady did not approve of Jack and Ann living without the benefit of marriage. So they never really got along too well, but when we showed up with the Model T, we went to their garage sale, and we made friends with them. By the time we left, everybody was having dinner with each other, and it was just a good old laugh. It's true.
During the time, that tree had uprooted a chunk of the sidewalk and it heaped it up, and the city would come along and they jackhammered or hauled off the old parts of the sidewalk, and they came in during the time that we were there, they re-poured it. But when they got done with their job, we took over. we finished the job for them. And Dave went, we pulled the license plate off the Model T and embedded it into the concrete enough
sisters. Supposed to be.
Oh, the three sisters, okay, and the cloud in the background, the Model T. And so then, and we signed it and said where we're from. And of course, you can see 1977, it's got the date on there. So, and there's Ann in there, Herbert, she's up there signing. So anyhow, several years later, they sold the place and moved to North Carolina. And I went back and visited them in North Carolina. And they said the hardest thing that for them to leave behind when they moved to North Carolina was that chunk of concrete.
They couldn't take it with them.
Couldn't take it with them. It meant a lot to them. So they.
That's wonderful.
Yes. So anyhow, I don't know if the city appreciated it, but they did.
Here we are on TV, New York Station.
See the bow tie?
Dave's getting interviewed with his bow tie on.
I even pulled my hair. But that guy, his nickname was Spanky, and all he ate was meat.
Meat, potatoes?
And Pepsi.
And Pepsi.
And that was his diet.
Well, that was have been slightly larger than that, but almost nothing else. That was... So there's a cobblestone street. We're in the Northeast now. And we're up to Binghamton is what they consider upstate. And that, so if you look at New York's kind of triangular shape, so it's up near toward the Niagara Falls area. And so the people there, they consider themselves different than this New York City. They like to think of themselves as not New York City. And Jack, or Spanky, he was kind of a trivia guy. He liked trivia. And so early on when we got to know him, he said, you guys, where you're from out there in Oregon and here, right here in this Binghamton area, is the two most dialect-free areas of the United States. And I'd never heard anything like that before. But you know, when you thought about it, the way they talked, there was no twang, there was no Boston accent, there was no Southern. They were very, it's just like if we're sitting here, you know, conversing.
Because we sure ran into some accents.
Yeah. So, anyhow, that was one of the trivia things that I thought was interesting that he shared with us. And then we were there, we'd ordered the parts, time was going on, we knew it was going to be a while. And he had, this guy was very great, had his body shop, but he also would go and buy junker cars, which is, you know, the low end of the trade is. He'd go to the local car lots and he'd buy these. Junkers, or they ran, but barely. And he'd take them back to his body shop and put some new plugs in them or do the minimal he could to get it running pretty good. And then he'd sell them to the people who couldn't afford a part. And he was his own collection agent. So he was quite an interesting character. He packed heat with him a lot of the time. And he'd tell somebody how he felt, what he thought about things. So anyhow, we got to go on one of his runs with him. I think all of us went. Mm-hmm. He called up one of his buddies. We had several trade-ins that he wanted off his lot. So he said, well, I got to get some cars. You guys want to go? Yeah. Let's see how all that went. So he goes over there and he goes in the office for a while and talks to the guy and they exchange some cash. Okay, we got to I got six cars. We got to get them back down to the body shop. So each of us get to go hop into one of his old beaters and just help him drive him back, shuffle him back to his body shop. So that was a big adventure for us. It was fun. But anyhow, he had some not too great of vehicles. One of them was this 1967 Mercury. But it ran good, but it didn't look too good. He said, since you guys need to wait a while to get these parts, and he said, I know time's getting short for Dennis. You guys are quite a ways from Maine yet. He said, if you want, you just take that Mercury, and since you can use that, you can go on, let Dennis see Maine. And he says, when you come back, maybe your parts will be here, and you can fix your car. So we are moving on now to get to Maine. We're in this neighborhood here. We stopped because we thought these buildings were neat. And we got out, and we're wandering up the street. We're taking pictures this way and that way. And a couple of kids come by on their bicycles. They kind of curious what we're doing. So they came over, I think Dennis or Dave told them, well, we're just
stopping here because we want to get some pictures to record this, because next month we hear they're coming in here, they're going to tear all this area down and make a big old wall.
Those kids took off on the bicycle really fast.
So there's a lot of neat old Thai old style construction in the Northeast. We kind of enjoy getting to see that. And then this is, you said, the capital.
Yeah.
So anyhow, we traveled on a few pictures of some neat houses. We get into, where do we get, the Maine is, where we went into Maine is on the New Hampshire-Maine border. I think there was a river, and we went into Maine enough to kind of say we got there, and we wanted to get some pictures of that fact with all three of us, and then we had a lobster meal, I think, when we were in Maine, so we had lobster Maine. So we got several different pictures kind of in this area. Get to see Maine, and then this is Dennis's last hours of this, because from here, we had to zoom back into Boston for him to make his flight. Yeah, that's what part of the East Coast looks like. We weren't overly impressed. I mean, it was almost like a lake shore. There was not very much in the way of waves, and there was not much in the way of sand. And I guess it gets a little more interesting during hurricane season. And then as we got, well, from there, then we headed back, and we were, oh, yeah, we had to get to the airport. We were pushing, because Dennis's flight, you know, how flights are, they have a certain time. And we're in that old 67 Mercury, and we were heading through town, and Boston has traffic circles. Anybody familiar with those things and like them? Well, we weren't very familiar with them, and I didn't like them very well. But we had the advantage. We're in the old beater car. And some of those are like four lanes wide, and you go into them, and you can merge clear in and clear back out. I don't know how they could hardly use four lanes. They did it, but it was quite a battle getting through those dang things. And you know, we don't know the roads very well or where we're headed or how to get there, and we're bombing through Boston trying to get there, but we made it. But that was another experience. And with Dennis headed for home, Dave and I stopped at this antique store here, and we got several chairs, I think nine, before we got out of here. And of course, we were pretty well loaded in the Model T, getting back to Jack Mann's place.
Well, we're still in your Mercury.
Oh, that's right. We're in the Mercury. Yeah,
those
right.
All went in just fine.
Yeah, it took a little maneuver, but we got them in there. We get back to Jack and Ann's, and the valves had come in. And so we went down to that guy's service station, and he said, well, you can work on it there. He pointed out to the street corner, so we're about on the sidewalk. Where he gave us a place to be able to work on it. And that's Jack's body shop. The body shop. Right across the road. See? And then, note, there's an interesting car, an old car kind of above Dave's head there. You'll see that again later. And so we worked on the Model T, took the radiator off, a bunch of stuff off it, so we could get the valves replaced. And then, got it running, and then we headed back toward Maine.
So wait a second, what did you do with the chairs?
Well, we left them with Jack and Ann because we're going to go back. We're coming back to New York.
Yeah, we came back to that place.
And they came back in America, and then got in tea and took that car out to Maine for the second trip to Maine, Dave and Kirk.
First time was just to get you to Maine to make sure you were going to make it. And the second time was to get the Model T into Maine to say
to Eastport, because Eastport was our goal, because it was like the farthest east point on the East Coast when we looked at the map. So that's why Eastport was our goal.
So then they go with the T back to Jack and Ann's because Kirk's time was short. We can go all about that.
Yeah. So here we're at the elevation, crossing over the Appalachians, and as we were going along, of course, evening came, and we were looking for a place to stay. And so we stopped and talked to some folks at a dairy, and if there's some place that they might think we'd be able to camp for the night. And they said, oh,
elevation.
Oh, yeah, go ahead.
Well, that elevation is the exact same elevation as the little airstrip where I live in Mattress.
No, is it?
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, it's 4 feet different. I'm 2360.
Yeah. And this light good. This light good. The top of the Appalachians. And it was really, it was a neat place to camp. So then the next morning we went down and the folks at the dairy, we saw how they were doing their dairying and whatnot. And then we visited with them and gave them rides, and it was kind of late before we got out of there, but it was a fun chance to get to meet them and visit with them and stay there. And then we continued on, and I don't remember what river it is, but that river was running really shallow and wide, and those rocks, there was a, you could walk clear across the river and back and not get your feet wet. You could then just, there's a bunch of old junk by the road, there are old engines and stuff lined up, so we had to stop in there. We got to visit this guy, he was more character. So he had some kind of a story about that bell.
Cast in 1664.
Okay, you're pointing to it there. And we got to Maine finally with the Model T now. Gotta find another camp spot. And this is where we're getting. Either we're at Eastport or close to it. It was really windy, and we were having to wonder how could we get hold on. It was so dang windy coming through here, but it held together. When we got into Eastport, and then the rain started coming, and so we had to get the side curtains on it.
Kirk is enjoying his celebratory cigar there.
Yeah, we had made it to our easternmost destination that we dreamed that we might get to. And so we got a motel room, we got cigars, and gosh dang, it tasted terrible. It wasn't worth this. But I gotta say, I gotta recall that when we were at this motel the next morning, Dave and I were getting our stuff together, packed up, getting up, put the Model T, and as usual, people were around. There's a couple of older guys that were there. And so we got to visit with them when we came out. And while we were visiting, Dave leaned against the radiator and just fiddling around, he took the radiator cap and he started turning it off, lifted the radiator cap and looked in, there was a silver dollar laying in the radiator under the cap. And so he reached in and he said, hey, look at this. And he reached in and he fished that silver dollar out. And those two guys we were visiting with, they kind of were standing there with bit of a smile on their face, and one of them said, it was worth it. The chance for them to see that car and get to visit with us. Had a lot of forgiveness, or clams, or something. We looked at that picture before, and I wasn't sure if he was eating it or didn't like it.
I didn't like it, but I did eat it.
And another off the side of the road camp spot. You didn't have to get very far, and just kind of people could sit by and not even know you were there.
The story behind that is those folks were from Bend, Oregon, and I was headed that way, and they were coming towards us. They saw the license plate, and they turned around and caught up to me, and I knew their son. Yeah. So we had lunch there. We had peanut butter, jelly, sandwiches on the little kitchen.
The significance of why we wanted to take this picture is look at those buildings. They're all together. This is a cold climate up there in the winter time, and I think that the word was that gave them a way to get from the house to their outbuildings and stuff without having to shovel snow and go out in the snow. I mean, yeah, I'm sure they had to do something because of being rural and down the cattle. They can still go from building to building without ever having to go up. Oh no, this is one. On one of them, maybe I've already passed it, we had the radiator, top of the radiator of the Model T was the top tent post guy wire to it, so that would help move the tent up to that way. This was a ski resort, I guess. I mean, said it was, but we weren't very impressed. So when we got back to Jack and Ann, we had visited with them, and you know, all Jack's
cartload of beaners were for sale. And he let us take this one and drive it. So I talked to him, I said, I made a deal with him to buy it. And then I said, well, if you buy it and you don't mind, he said, I'll buy that Plymouth if you'll tow it back to Oregon for me. So all that transpired, and then I had to get the Plymouth ready, or no, I had to get the Mercury ready because come to find out two motor mounts were broken in it, so I had to replace two motor mounts, had to hook it up to tow, get a hitch put on it, and then I had to get the hitch part of it for the old car, the Plymouth, had to get that all set up. So that took me a while doing that and get my, you know, my life bar. And I thought, well, since it looks kind of like a pretty low class outfit, I spelled in tow appropriately for the looks of the outfit. That's how I towed it all the way across.
Well, it's kind of shaped like a big toe.
So, let's see, it's kind of maybe. So from there, we were saying our goodbyes. We were all hooked up. I was hooked up, ready to go. Dave was getting his tee loaded, and he posed for a picture here before we took off. And when I got out to the freeway, and the front brakes in that Plymouth walked up, they were dragging it up, that they were expanding, and finally I decided I better not go on the freeway, this is the way this is. So on the on-ramp, I pulled off to the side, I pulled both front wheels off, took the brake shoes out. And then I got it back together and headed west, and I went about 600 or 700 miles every day. And it towed pretty good going straight or on freeways, but if I tried to turn off, go in and maneuver around to get the gas and stuff, then it wanted to kind of drag around the corners. Followed too good then, and that got the bug in me. So I tried changing the toe in, and that didn't help. And I wore one front tire out, and had to get a new tire for it, and a replacement tire.
You did all this for him?
Yeah. And then also, when I realized I wasn't going to fix the steering problem, then I bought about 3 5-gallon gas cans. So I pull in, fuel the car up, and all those gas cans. And so then I had another fuel stop somewhere along just the side of the freeway at a rest stop or whatever. I dumped those 3 jugs of gas in it and it kept going. It took me 4 days or something like that across the United States with that outfit. So, but Dave still is in the Model T.
So I'm home on my E-Lonesome now. I got rid of the 2 dead weights. So the car really cruised. So what do? I stopped at this guy's place. I don't remember how I met him, but out in the back pasture was a Model T engine. Well, I didn't have any other engines, and I kind of wanted one. Just so he loaded, he gave it to me, so we put it in the back seat. So now I had more dead weight again. And the car did fine. The reverse springs were kind of flattish, but it did okay. And this guy wanted to trade cars, but Lizzie been so good to me, I couldn't trade her off. But that's a 1910 Thomas Flyer, and the guy took me for a ride in it, and at 55 miles an hour, it was just playing. It was, maybe I should have traded.
Dave had to take pictures right by setting his camera up, and then going and getting in it, had to do a time delay.
In that country, you'd be on the back roads, and there'd be apple trees and crab apple trees everywhere, and they lower branches. You could just stand up and pick fruit out of a tree. That's why that fruit swing in there. Just some good old boys, and they had southern drawls, the strongest I've ever heard. But as I went further south, the draw got less and less. But this is an area that a lot of outsiders don't move into and defuse that draw. I stayed on this place. Old lady lived there, and she told me that there's some apple trees in the back row. She said those were camped under by Union troops during the Civil War. Interesting. I'm headed to Florida, South Carolina, getting hot and humid.
So yeah, did I forget to put the top up? Oh no, not yet.
Finally had to put the top up. Not yet. Just a gas station, the guy owned a Model A, so I got a picture of it. Stayed, this is in Georgia. The farmer let me stay out in this field and under this chestnut tree.
And they were big and green and heavy, and they'd fall out at night, and wham, they hit the fenders. So I figured if one of those hit me, I was going to do me in. So I slept under the car that night. Well, that's him. He gave me a watermelon. That's his daughter. And I had dinner with them, and they were Southern, proper. The women sat, and they did not speak unless spoken to, and the dad did all the talking. And as soon as I met the daughter the next day, he said, "Well, we'll see you later." He had really red hair. It was as red as that red Georgia clay soil. Kudzu. I stopped just long enough to get this picture, because if I had stayed very long, it would start growing over my car. Really fast-growing stuff. And while I was there, a car went by. And, well, several cars, but there was one that went by, and it turned out to be someone that lived in Warm Springs. And he owned the restaurant there where the bridge is at Warm Springs. His name was Macy.
Richard
Macy was my homeroom teacher. And he realized if that was me, he saw in that Model T clear down in the country. Roadside camp, hot and humid, the tin is just sagging with moisture. Ran across this guy in a restaurant, and he said, "Well, come out, look at my Model T out of my place." So there it is. He said it'd be 60 miles an hour. It had a Model T truck rear end in it. Model T's sometimes on a cooler morning, you crank them up and they want to move ahead, the clutch discs kind of skitch. Well, that happened here. And it took off and I had to chase it down.
What's
remember
it say on your slow-moving vehicle?
Well, Dennis thought we ought to have that, and it probably saved our lives a few times.
Just,
oh, it says...
Just Farmers from Oregon.
Yeah. O-R-Y-G-U-N.
Now, that is higher than the top of Mount Good. And so I'm really... not many pictures left here. I have film that's got a funny speed to it, so it gives a blue cast. But that's 12,000 some feet on Loveland Pass. And at that, and I just got done staying 3 days at a guy's place in Denver. Didn't get any pictures of him. His name was Bob Plagey, and he was the president of the Model T Ford Club of America. And I was moving through Colorado, and came across a white spot in the road, and here's all these Model T's sitting here all decked out, and everyone's in period clothing, and I saw them, and I just turned around and went back, and got to visiting with them, and they looked at my Oregon place, and said, "Oh, you're coming from Oregon?" I said, "No, I'm going back." And they had gone like 30 miles, and it was an arduous journey, and they were headed to a place called Castle Rock to be in a parade. So I joined in with them, and I went and drove through the parade. And he wrote a little article up in the Model T magazine about this trip. And one thing I did, he took a picture of it, it's in the magazine, is when I wanted to wash my hands because I had been messing with the tea and they get greasy. Well, you get down in front of the radiator and you open that petcock and the water coming out was just perfect temperature, warm. And I had a towel over my shoulder and I was down there washing my hands and I get to looking around and here's all these feet around me. I had this crowd that couldn't believe what I was doing. He was a lot of fun. And anyway, went up to the top of Loveland Pass. You could take a tunnel if you wanted, but I wanted to go over the top. And I passed motorhomes and trucks because they couldn't turn their mixture down to meet the altitude. And I could, but I was in low gear the whole time, and I'd be over in the shoulder. And I'd come up behind a truck or a motorhome and I'd pull out slowly and go around. That's Great Salt Lake. And it's nice and warm. It looks cool because of the tint. So I had to drive out. That thunderstorm caught up with me and the lake turned into a lake. And I found all I had to do was put on the side curtain on the driver's side and I could leave the one off on the far side because the rain just didn't come in and get you. The cars on this side would stir up enough rain and this and that, it'd come in and get you. So I only had to run the one side curtain. So I figured out that the thing would start running rough. And I had to do it like three more times coming across country. It would start running rough, so I'd pull ahead, I used the same gasket over and over because I didn't know you weren't supposed to, but I never had a problem. And I could take the two little covers off of the valve galleys, and I could get in there and I could take the little keeper off and release the spring tension, and I could lap the valve in. I bought a lapping stick and some lapping compound, and in about 1 hour I'd have the valves lapped just as soon as they started getting carbon, and that way they never really got damaged. I could get that carbon off and then I was good to go. But I knew the symptoms when it was time to do it again. So that fixed that. That's Malheur Cave. I knew how to get into it. It wasn't marked at the time. It goes a half mile down in there and then you come to a lake and it goes, and there's a boat sitting there. You could get in the boat and paddle until you could go no further. But while I was here, I stayed overnight. There was this two old dudes in this old pickup with a camper, and they opened the door and said, hey, come on over and have a drink with us. So I did. And they said, well, where are you from? What's your name? And I said, oh, I'm Dave Campbell from Madras, Oregon. And one guy looked at me and he goes, do you know a bull camel? And well, it turns out he met my Uncle Ted. And in the Navy, my Uncle Ted's nickname was Bull. And then that's the end.
Dave got back. See what got home.
Yep.
Made it home. Thank you, guys. Okay, so folks, we thank everybody for staying. We want to thank Kirk and Dennis and Dave for this fascinating show. It had to have been a fascinating trip across the Model T Ford. If you haven't been in Model T Ford on a long trip, you've missed something, because there's really something. So we've really enjoyed you guys here. So I think they still got a little bit of food over there that they're going to save for us in here. So anyway, thanks for coming. And tell everybody about the museum up here. We're pretty proud of it.
Thank you.